Good morning, everyone. Welcome here. We're excited to worship with you guys this morning. We're part of the band that was here this weekend with your students. So if you guys would stand and worship with us, we're going to sing some praises to our God. You guys know this. Sing it out. This is Amazing Grace.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Who breaks the power?
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty? And so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings.
Sing it out. This is amazing grace.
This is amazing. Amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That
this song this weekend. It's called Risen King. So you guys sing it out.
Chose the nails that pardon my soul.
you sing this out?
May be seated. Good morning. Welcome to First Baptist Church this morning. It is a delight to see each and every one of you here with us this morning. This morning, the announcements are going to be on video, and they are brought to you by the Children's Ministry here at First Baptist Church.
I'm Presley.
And I'm Krissa.
And we are a part of the Children's Ministry here at First Baptist Church. And right now, you're watching FBC TV,
where we take a few moments each week to let you know what is happening in your church during the upcoming weeks. Let's take a look.
It has been a fantastic weekend of DNOW activities. If you are visiting with us today, or you are a part of the DNOW family, we are delighted that you are here. We are looking forward to learning more about what God is doing in the lives of the youth in Barmore County.
Summer is over and the choir bells are officially ringing. If you are interested in joining any of the choirs of FBC or the handbell team, please see today's church bulletin for complete details concerning practice time and locations.
Are you a Sunday school teacher or small group leader? If so, make plans now to attend the luncheon next Sunday, honoring you for your service. The luncheon will be held at noon in the merge. Be sure to RSVP for this event by calling the church office no later than September 21st.
Both the CDC Council and Church Council and Deacons will meet today. The CDC Council will meet at 3 p.m. in room 210, and Church Council and Deacons will meet at 4:30 in room 202.
Ladies, do you have your tickets for the Bethmore simulcast? If not, please contact the church office as soon as possible. Tickets are $20 and the event will be held this Saturday in the Merge. You don't want to miss what is sure to be a great day of learning and fellowship.
You've been watching FBC TV, where we're giving God glory and giving people hope.
Be sure to join us on the campus of FBC each Wednesday,
where the passengers and pilots of Flight Night take off at 6:30 p.m. and merge doors open to all youth at 6:45. We hope that you have a great service. Pastor Keith.
Nope.
We missed.
Y'all need to give it up for those kids. That's amazing. I have had a very emotional experience today, and I've already wept a few tears, and that's for several reasons. Number one, I'm an Alabama Crimson Tide fan, and so I was a little shaky when the day began. And but the other thing is to look out and see all these purple shirts, and to have interacted with these young people over the course of this weekend. Just been a fantastic weekend. And I want to say, if you're my age, maybe a little older, I know how easy it is for you to look at the future and look at the shape of our world and wonder, what in the world are we going to do? And when you get that way, here's what I want to urge you to do. Stop looking at CNN. Stop looking at Fox News. Start looking at these young people and start remembering that Jesus said, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Guys, we're really glad you're here, and it's just a thrill to me to look out and see you. And the other thing that just thrills my soul is to look out and see Barnwell First Baptist Church and Haygood Avenue Baptist Church, and we're gathered here together and we're worshiping the Lord together, and I just think that that's a testimony that the world needs. needs to see, when they focus on all the things that are wrong with the church, they're neglecting this today. And so I'm delighted to ask Pastor Ken Cato, if I can find Pastor Ken. There he is. He's going to come and say a word to us and pray for us as well. God bless you, brother.
I'll bring you greetings from the Haygood Avenue Baptist Church, your daughter. 1950, you planted a great church just over there. And I get the pleasure of pastoring that good church that you planted, and it's an awesome experience. And I'm so excited to meet with you guys. You guys are the ones who has given us the opportunity to kick Satan in the shins this morning and worship together. Two churches in the same city, not competing with anything other than to whip Satan and to lift Jesus. And so I'm grateful for that. It's a great opportunity for us to be here. Thank you so much, Brother Pastor Keith and your staff and everybody for giving us the privilege to come and worship with you today. Ministerially speaking, I think we about just got standing room only today, so I'm excited about that. Let's go to God in prayer. Lord, you have been just too good to us, and we thank you so much for loving us and caring for us. We thank you for meeting the needs that we had, and Father, we thank you for loving us enough to put your Son on the cross to pay our debt. And then, Father, calling us into your family, receiving us, commissioning us to be your spokespersons in this world. So, God, thank you for the privilege we have to do just that. And so today, as we worship you in spirit and in truth, and we welcome you, Lord, to this service, and we ask you, accomplish what you want done today. Save a lost soul. Bring someone back. Lift a burden. Give direction in life. God, this service belongs to you. Now, Father, we wait for you. In fact, thank you already for what you're about to do. In the amazing name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
We're going to worship with another song. Most of y'all should be familiar with. It's called How He Loves. And, let's just take this time to focus on how much the Lord loves us. And it's really easy to forget, but He is so much stronger and so much better. And we just feel satisfied with knowing that He loves us so much, even after all of the sins that we do day to day. So y'all sing this out.
Oh, love aside.
continue to sing of our Father's redeeming love for us.
Praise the Lord, but there are people who make this kind of event possible, and I think we need to thank our praise team. Janie, thank you. Caroline, thank you. Landon, thank you so much. We've come to a time in our service when we have the privilege, the opportunity to give back to the Lord, and I don't usually set ground rules for offerings, but I have a couple for today, all right? If you're from Haygood, and you make your check out to Haygood Baptist Church, we'll be sure that it gets to the right place, okay? If you write on an envelope, Haygood or HABC, whatever you want to write to indicate to us that that should go to Haygood, we'll get it there. If you just put cash in the offering plate, you're going to have to call and tell us that you meant it to go to Haygood. And Brother Ken, please don't call and tell me that you threw 5,000 cash in the plate. Let's give thanks to the Lord and ask Him to bless us now. Father, You've blessed us with so much. This weekend has just been wonderful. You've blessed us with Your Son. You've blessed us with Your Spirit. You've blessed us with one another. You've blessed us with joy. You've blessed us with peace. You've blessed us with everything that's really meaningful in our lives. We want to come now and say, we love You, and we thank You, and we trust You, and we want to show our gratitude in the way that we give back to You. So help us to do that with free and generous hearts now, in the name of Your Son, the unspeakable gift.
This morning, I have the privilege of inviting three of our students up. Renee, Morgan, and Benjamin are three of the students that were here for DNOW this weekend. And if I can go ahead and have them come up, what better way to hear about the experiences from this weekend than from the students that were actually able to participate and the students that had their lives changed as a result of it? You know, Chris and I can tell you story after story from our perspective, but if the focus of the weekend is on these kids, what better way to hear about it than from them? So if y'all want to go ahead and go.
Hi, I'm Renee.
Hi, Renee.
All right. At the beginning of this weekend, I looked at our small group leader while we were having our first meeting, and I said, I'm so sorry if I cry, that I'm probably going to cry at least 7 times this weekend. I've already cried 6. So if this happens to me on my 7th, I am so sorry. Anyway, I came in this weekend and she asked us what we wanted to accomplish this weekend. And everybody was like, oh, well, I want to know how to let go of my pain, my anger, things like that. And I was like, I just want to be a Christian. And I've wanted to for a long time, and it became one of those things that I was trying too hard to believe when all I really had to do was let it go, and everything came. Our pastor this weekend, who I don't think he's here. No, he left last night. He is really rad. He's Pastor Fudd, and I have never met a man so interesting in my life. That's probably a lie, actually. Sorry. Sorry. But, I don't want to cry, so my other thing is, like, I'm going to get everybody to laugh so I don't cry. But he was preaching, and in the middle of his sermon, he was like, you know what, I'm going to go to a psalm that I like. And I have been reading the Bible this weekend, even before I accepted Christ and before I realized everything. I had been reading, and one time I was like, you know what, I'm just going to open it up, and whatever God leads me to, he's leading me to it. So I opened up my Bible, had my eyes closed, put my finger on a psalm, and I read it, and it didn't make much sense, because it just wasn't in context. I didn't understand what he was trying to say there. And that night, Pastor Fudd was like, you know what, I'm gonna read a psalm for you guys. And it was the exact same psalm I had opened up to. And then I realized that God was up there going, hey Renee, you don't believe? I'm gonna blow your mind. I have always thought for the longest time that God just had something against me. That he was like, you know, you're not doing good, so I'm going to punish you in every way possible. I just don't like you. Like some people at school, you know, they just don't like you. Or some people at work or whatever, they just don't like you, so they're trying to make your life hard. I was almost positive that's what God was doing to me. Like, oh, you don't believe? Have fun with that. And for the longest time, I was determined that God hated me. And this was a God that was not supposed to hate anyone. And I was like, then why do you hate me? God loves each and every one of us so much. That's all I ever wanted to know. That's all I ever wanted to feel. I can't. I'm sorry. I'm done.
Hello. Okay. This week was probably one of the best the now weekends I've ever had. And it's just not something that you get to experience every day. Peters, I'm not good at this, you know this. But they were talking about desires this week. Having weak and then strong desires. And it was just something different. Something that I hadn't thought of. And I honestly thought that was really cool. I guess I'm just trying to say, don't have weak desires. Have strong ones. One. ones for God and his mission. That's just about it, honestly.
Okay, I'm Morgan, and I've learned a lot of stuff that I never thought I would this weekend. It has changed my life a lot. After the session we had last night, it was very emotional for me. And after I talked to Olivia, Chris, my brother, and Spencer Caroline, and I decided that I wanted to be saved last night. I really don't know what to say. I'm not good at talking. He saved me. He took away my sins and he took control of my life.
I don't think I need to add anything to that.
Well, I get the glory and pleasure to add to that. So I almost just was like, let it go, you know, let them have it. That's amazing, right? Yeah, like, I mean, that's what it's all about. It's just about the love of God, and it was so simple, and the gospel in that way is so simple. And all these students said was, I just wanted to know that there's a God that loves me and died for me. It was so simple. And that was amazing and beautiful what these students are just saying this morning. And so this morning I get the joy and the privilege of bringing the word this morning and bringing kind of a recap and kind of an end cap to this weekend of DNOW. My name is Chris Kerger. I'm the student pastor at Haygood Avenue Baptist Church. And this is my pleasure of my fourth DNOW here in Barnwell. And my second one here as us together as one body. And so if you have your Bibles this morning, I pray that you'll open up to Galatians chapter 5. Galatians chapter 5 is where we've been this weekend. I had the pleasure of bringing in my youth minister for the speaker this weekend. He led me to the Lord when I was a sophomore in high school. And so it was just kind of emotional in that way, in a really cool way where sort of the roles have been reversed. So as you turn in your Bibles to Galatians chapter 5, I'll go ahead and kind of explain that Paul, as he wrote the book of Galatians, Paul is trying to correct doctrine. And finally, in chapter 5, he kind of gives this application of that doctrine. And the header in my Bible says that Christ has set us free. And this weekend, that was my heart. Back in February and March when I sat down and I decided to, what could we talk about? September 18th coming up. What are some things that we really need to hear? What's the word of God that we need to hear this morning? And so God laid this on my heart back in February. And honestly, the conviction that I was under was that there's far too many Christians who consider themselves saved, but their life looks nothing like it. And that burdened me. That I see believers claim Christ, but then that means nothing in some ways. And that burdened me. And the students, we have conversations about walking with God and the process of sanctification after we trust in Christ, the process for the rest of our lives, trusting in the Lord. And so I really just wanted to hone in on this idea this weekend as Paul talks in Galatians about how we can be set free from the chains of this life. And we can be set free from addiction, and we can be set free from ourselves, honestly. We're going to look at that this morning. So if you have your Bibles, look at Galatians 5, verse 1. It says, "For freedom, Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not again submit to a yoke of slavery." And so this is the idea that this one verse just is the key theme of this weekend. And I pray this morning it's the key theme of your life as well. For freedom, Christ has set us free. So his word is telling us that for the sake of freedom, Christ died. And that might be a little countercultural to some of us, almost counter church if we think about it really. Because how many times do we submit another word as why Christ set us free? We might put another word in there. Christ did this for my freedom, but he's saying he died so that we may be free. And freedom, as we're going to look in a minute, is freedom in Christ. Some people get nervous when we start talking about freedom and grace. Like, I can't control that. I can't hone in on those ideas. They're kind of vague. But as we're going to look in a minute, freedom is in Christ, and God has all things in control. And so we can trust his freedom is good. And so as we look in this, we're going to see that we're set free from something, and we're set free to something. We're set free from something, and we're set free to something. So what are those somethings? So it's free. If Christ's whole purpose was to set us free, what did he set us free from? And the first thing, if you're taking notes, he set us free from slavery, as he says in his word. And slavery, I'm going to define slavery to our own godness. I've never met anyone, I've never walked up to someone and said that they confess that they believe that they're God. I've never met anyone that actually had that conversation, but I've seen people live their life as if they are God. And they believe that their world revolves around them and their decisions, and they control this thing. That they determine the path. But the problem is that when you say you're your own authority, you now then have put a yoke on your shoulders that you are unable to bear. When you are your own God, you have to figure out what leads to your fulfillment. And how have you been doing it that? How have we been doing it earning our own salvation or earning our satisfaction? How have we been doing it that? And if you examine your life, you probably cannot find the thing that satisfies. If you really start to hone in on your heart, you go, man, I thought it was this relationship. I thought it was this addiction. I thought it was this thing. I thought it was going here and doing this. But every time that thing ends, I'm more dissatisfied than when I started. So when you're not willing to submit to something greater than you, you carry the weight of your life. You have to define this thing. So what ends up happening is you run for a while in a certain direction, and you say, well, it can't be that. So you turn and you run a while, and then it can't be that. And you just spend your whole life enslaved to yourself. And this is what slavery looks like. You're in chains. The patterns over and over and over. And I will swear from my own testimony, it's true. I was saved from the patterns of my own sin. And a great example of what this looks like is when it comes to the problem of suffering. Because all of a sudden, you are no longer in control of that. And all of a sudden, you're grasping for control, but things are happening around you. A loved one dies unexpectedly. or something, you get an illness and you just can't control these things and you're grasping for the answers. A tragedy happens. And it's in these moments that if you are God, you cannot fix it. And so you're looking to yourself for the solution. And 9 times out of 10, y'all listen, 9 times out of 10, in those moments, bitterness and frustration come. Because you can't break the cycle. You can't break it. You think in some way we think we can. But the cycle continues. And honestly, that yoke that Paul is talking about crushes us. It crushes us. So the first thing is we're free from being God. We're free from that. The second thing is we're free from empty religion. And so empty religion is this idea that the moment you decide that some sort of religious practice is going to give you right standing before God, it's called legalism. That some sort of prayer night, or some of you in this room think that coming to church every Sunday is going to gain you something in heaven. And so some of you are concerned with, like, I want to be right with God, so I'm going to do certain things. I'm going to pray, and I'm not advocating we don't do those things, but it comes from something, not for something. And so some of us have this empty religion where maybe you were younger, and heaven and hell were presented to you, and you start weighing the options. I don't know many people that would go, I'll go with the hell option. I don't know many people that when those are presented before them, choose. Most people, when they want to save their souls, they're going, yes, heaven. What do I have to do? Okay, Jesus, yes. All right, cool, I'm good. And so the rest of their life, they have empty religion because their salvation was just an idea. It wasn't a person. And so they're just searching. And so we do this, and Paul's talking to Galatians about this whole idea of empty religion. And so what's motivating all of our affections and all of our drive is not Jesus, but it's religion. And it's so pervasive, and it happens so fast. And so what happens with empty religion is we have to keep doing and doing and doing. And then we start to feel that guilt if we haven't. And then what happens is you, if you struggle with empty religion, you're going to look to your left and your right, and you're going to go, I went to that Bible study, but my neighbor didn't. Or, you know, I read my Bible 3 times a week, and I know a lot of people don't do that. And so you start to play this comparison game with your whole faith. Your whole faith is just, I'm doing better than the next guy. I'm doing better than the next guy. That's slavery. There's no joy when all you're doing is trying to be better than the next guy. There's no fulfillment in Christ. So Christ has saved us first from being God, and second from just empty religion where we just go through the motions and we just do because we're taught to do. And so I said a minute ago, if we're saved from those things, what are we saved to? So we're saved to not being God. We're saved to knowing God, the true God, Yahweh, God of the universe. And we're saved to be in right relationship with Him. If you know your Bibles, Genesis chapter 1 talks about God walking in the cool of the day with Adam and Eve. This has always been His design, was for God to walk with us in right relationship with no shame, no fear. He is our God and we are His people, has always been His message. Problem is Adam and Eve disobeyed God's command. Brokenness came. All things were fractured. The relationship was now broken. And all of Israel's redemptive history comes up to a man named Christ. It all points to a man named Jesus, who is the Messiah. And so now we're saved by Him, fulfilling and now bringing that relationship back to where it always was meant to be. And so now we're saved to a relationship with God. And so now if you're not God, you don't have to figure out the purpose for your life. It's not your responsibility. You now can give that to the Lord, who's in control of all things. And now when you walk through seasons of suffering and doubt, you know that there's a God in heaven who's controlling all things. And it might not make sense to you in this temporary life, but there's a God in heaven who's orchestrating all things to his glory. And so now when you walk through seasons of doubt and suffering, he's getting glory somehow. I know that that might seem real tough in some seasons, but there's a trust there that surpasses all understanding. There's a peace now. When you're free in Christ, there's a peace that surpasses all understanding. So when you walk through seasons of suffering and doubt, you just depend on him. It's not, you can't fix it. You don't know how to get out of it, but you can say, you can. You can get me out of this thing. You can move the pieces, Lord. It's not on me. And you're free. You're free to trust in him because he's good. His mercies reign forever. And his grace surpasses everything. And so we can trust in him. And we don't have to figure it out. We don't have to have it all figured out. We can have faith. And so we get to now have that right relationship where we go, this is how it's designed to be. And this is where I rest in his work. So like I said, we're set free from ourselves and we're set free from our empty religion and we're saved to life in Christ. So we don't have to go through these motions anymore. There's a real person. I think I'm in a seminary class. I'm taking systematic, and we were talking about the Holy Spirit, and he's a real person. There's a God at the other end of this conversation. I felt like in my prayer life, I would just talk to this. I'm just praying. And it hit me as we talked, and there's a person on the other end that's listening. But faith comes by believing. And so we have to just trust in his word. He's given us his word. And so it'll change our lives when we believe that we're saved in Christ, to Christ. And there's a real relationship that's happening. And he bears that burden. I said that a minute ago, that there's a yoke of slavery on our shoulders. Well, if you know the story, you know that Christ himself bore the load. He himself was nailed. He himself was put in front of this world. And all of the weight of God's wrath was put on him. So that's what Paul's saying. He said, don't submit again to a yoke of slavery. Because he's understanding that if freedom has set you free, if Christ has set you free, you're not called to return to that. The psalmists write that only a dog returns to its vomit. It's the same idea. There's foolishness as we return to slavery if you've been free. There's this story I heard about an orphanage. Two parents come into this orphanage. It's grimy, it's dirty. Babies are unkept and unclean. But they had adopted this young baby, and so they came and they went to this orphanage and they found their son, 2-year-old, 3-year-old, and they took him, cleaned him up, put him in the car, and as they're driving away, the baby turned and said that he wanted to go back. But that child has no idea what he just said. Because he is on his way to a place that he has no understanding how great it could be. He just asked to go back to an orphanage where he was unclean and unkept and dirty and uncared for. But some of us think this way. As we're following Christ, we turn around and go, maybe that was better. And church, I want to submit to you this morning, that's exactly what Adam and Eve fell for. They said, maybe God's holding out from us. Maybe there's something better that God is just holding back from me. And like that baby in that orphanage, he had no idea what he's saying, because he has not seen the beauty of what is to come. A place where he has parents that care for him and feed him and love him, and was saved and redeemed from an orphanage of slavery. And so I want to submit that to you this morning, not to put the yoke back on your shoulders. When Christ died, he removed that from you and he took it on himself. So now perfection is found in him and not in you. I say this all the time. Jesus was perfect, so you don't have to be. And you're free. You're free from the weight and the guilt and the shame that comes from sin and brokenness. And Jesus put that on himself. Restored a right relationship with us. So let's look at that second part of verse 1. He says, for freedom Christ has set us free, stand firm. And it's very important that Paul puts that in there, stand firm. It's because we all have a tendency to move. When I talked about earlier, we have a tendency maybe to go the legalistic route, where we say, yes, Jesus, but I want to be right with you, so I'm gonna take this step this way. I want to make sure we're good, so I'm going to do some things. And that starts you down this road, but maybe some of us, I'm more prone to license, where I say, yes, Jesus, and then I go, maybe not, and maybe not. And then after a season, I find myself over here, and I go, I don't know. And so maybe that's one of you're in one or two categories where you find yourself moving. And so Paul is very clearly going, stand firm. And you're going to move. Every season has its different things. But he's saying stand firm and believe it, that you are free. You are free. Stand firm. Because we move. And if you look at your life, you know this. I'm not telling you anything you shouldn't already see. We're prone to wander. Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. We do this. So Paul is saying, stand firm. And do not submit again to your former life. You've been saved from that. It's crazy. You've been saved from that. So if we keep reading, look at verse 5, Galatians 5, 5. He says, for through the Spirit, by faith, we ourselves eagerly wait for the hope of righteousness. And so if we're going to move to Christ, there has to be something very clear that happens. Is verse 5, is through the Spirit. Through the Spirit and by faith we move into righteousness. So if you, this morning, you feel the freedom that Christ gives you, but you're struggling with the sanctification, you're struggling moving towards Christ, this is how we do it. Once again, it's not you. The Spirit of God is put in you to bring about good works. And so through the Spirit, righteousness comes from our lives. And so if you want to begin walking and standing firm and believing the freedom that you're in, it's through the Spirit of God Himself working in and through you. And in faith that is true, and both of those things together, Spirit and faith and Spirit and faith and Spirit and faith will keep you forever and ever in line with the will of God. Verse 6, for in Christ Jesus, he says, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision counts for anything. He's talking about if you move this way or this way, it doesn't really count, because Christ's move counted. Christ was always perfect. So it doesn't count. The legalism of the license counts for anything, but he says, and this is huge, this is where we want to go, but only faith working through love. Only faith working through love. Look at verse 14. For the whole, it says, Paul says, the whole law is fulfilled in one word. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. So maybe that's freedom for the person who thinks they should add things to Christ. Christ, or Paul's saying that whole entire 600 Jewish laws can be summed up in one word, and that's love. And so if you want to be set free this morning, you have to understand God's love for you. And I couldn't put it any more beautifully than Renee did. I couldn't have said that any better, that she just needed to know God's love. And she was free. And so he's saying that only through faith working through love is how we walk towards Christ. So if you've accepted Christ, he's your Savior, but you're struggling with the walk part, it's faith working through love. It's trusting Jesus. Faith. But it's with the lenses of love. And so there's a diagram as we become more Christ-like, there's a diagram is seen that you start out as a baby Christian, you see that you've been forgiven. But as you walk with Christ more and more and more, you see how much you've really been forgiven, becomes more aware to you, how much God has really saved you from. You didn't even realize it. And so faith working through love. And we have to put these glasses on. And this is my heart. Faith working through love. That means people are always the other end. And I've learned this in the past couple seasons of my life, is that when I come to Christ, and when we talk to him, he says, good, that's great, you've come to me. But now go love your brother like that. And he always keeps pointing me back. It's always come to him, and then he points me away from himself and says, now, do likewise. And if we know the story of Christ, that's what he does. He, go make disciples. Go love the least of these, the widow and the orphan. And so if you want to know this morning, confidently in Christ, if you have faith, how is your love? Who is at the other end of your faith? So if Christianity to you is just a personal thing, that's just me and the Lord, I think you've missed it. I believe you're saved, I just feel like you're missing some things. I believe your joy is hindered by not realizing that if you've been forgiven much, that you love much. When you understand what Christ has done for you, not counting equality with God a thing to be grasped, but humbling himself in the form of a servant and died, when you understand that happened, you go and do likewise. And that's when faith and love grow you into the mature believer you're called to be. And it's always this, every day you wake up and you go, faith in Christ, Jesus, you've set me free. Amen. Thank you. Now then you go. And you go into your workplaces and you go into your schools and you go wherever God has put you. And faith working through love until the ends of the earth, until Jesus Christ himself returns. It's faith working through love. And we need to keep reading because verse 7, Paul was just given verse 1 through 6. In verse 7, he goes, Galatians, you were running well. Who hindered you from obeying the truth? So they took a step away. And only it happens that fast. As I read verses 1 through 6, whatever, how many, 10 minutes has it been, verse 7 comes. And once again, we're called back to, where are we? We were running well. Who hindered you? In verse 9, a little leaven leavens the whole lump. Sin and the smallest form can corrupt the whole thing. Guys, the faith is not a... It's difficult. I'll just be honest with you. There's difficulties. I'm not going to sugarcoat that when you come to faith in Christ, it's rainbows and shiny days. There's a faith in Christ that happens. And in those moments, a little leaven, a little step in this way, Paul's saying a little step in that way, can destroy the whole thing. And so Paul is begging us as Christians to stand firm. Because you were running well. Who hindered you? Who made you forget that you've been set free? And so it happens so fast. And if you've been a believer for a time, you know that. You know that. It happens so fast. And so verse 13, for you are called to freedom, brothers. Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love, serve one another. That's all this weekend was about. For you are called to freedom. And freedom is in the Spirit. Freedom is in Christ. Do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh. Don't swing back to where you've been saved from. Don't go back to the orphanage where you've been saved from. And that's my plea this morning to all of you. Stand firm. Christ has saved you. Freedom. Fudd used a quote this weekend from C.S. Lewis, talking about how we'd rather play in the mud than spend a holiday at the sea. And use that illustration because this is what we do. And Benji was talking about our affections. We're satisfied with a little leaven. We're satisfied with a little, it's not that bad. We're satisfied with that. And we talked about affections. We should have great affections for God. But far too many times, we have lesser affections and we're almost satisfied, if you will, with these eternal or these earthly things. So I'm just begging us this morning. Do not use your freedom, brothers, as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love, serve one another. And this is different. It's not just, it has to be from the heart. Serving one another, that you have to have those lenses on. Because when you put those lenses on, I promise you things are going to change. Racism in our country goes away when Christ puts our glasses on. Christ, things change. You serve someone you don't care about. You start serving people that don't deserve it because you didn't deserve it. And things change. And you start jumping gaps socially, economically, and you start serving people. And if you see the people that Jesus hung out with, man, he wasn't supposed to be with them. So let's not, honestly, let's just be a little more radical. Let's just be a little more loving to the people who should be in this room this morning. Man, most of you, man, let's just be honest. Man, most of us have been going to church our whole lives. Let's be honest. We're the people that go to church. But if we serve those outside the church, man, this thing, we're going to have to blow out that wall. Man, it's all, that's love, serving, laying our lives down because we know what's happened to us. And that's what it means to walk with Christ. That's what faith looks like. The Bible and the prayer, those will come as you want to know more about who Jesus is. But you have to have the right glasses on. It's got to be going in the right direction. There's a soul at the end of this thing. I'm asking Caroline to kind of come over and kind of wrap this up. And so as we just finish, I just want to beckon you to not gratify the desires of the flesh, but walk by the Spirit. To walk by the Spirit. And so we'll just wrap up this D now. I'm just going to let you know that's like about 10 students this weekend were set free in Christ. Yeah, glory to God. Amen. Amen. But I know for a fact that there are people in this room that need to be set free this morning. They have set the example. They've laid their life down. As Morgan said it perfectly last night to me, she said, I want to be saved. I said, all right, what does that mean to you? And she goes, I surrender. That killed me. I was like, you get it. I was like, you get it. You surrender. She gets it. And I'm just going to tell you this morning that you can all have that. Every single one of you in this room that is presented to you this morning. If you don't know Christ, and we could talk about that. But I want you to know this morning that He loves you and He cares for you and He died for you. And so, Spirit, I just pray right now that you'll do something crazy. Man, Barnwell needs it. I love our town. But we need some believers to step up. I love our town, I promise you. And I'm here among us. And let's do the work. Let's go. So it's faith working through love. Man, if we get that, this world will change forever. Our city, our state, our country, man. Pastor Keith was talking about CNN, man. Fox News. You guys saw Charleston. You saw it. Faith working through love. The world didn't want that. But that's what it looks like, man. It crosses boundaries. It doesn't make sense to the world. So this morning, man, I just want to present that to you. I'm not sure about all the formalities, but man, if God's doing something, man, let's just come down front. If you want to use this time, just come, man. If you want to be set free, I'd want to be set free. Man, I just pray. I mean, let's just bow our heads then. Let's just bow our heads. Father, you are good. You're so good to us, Father. We don't deserve it. God, I just pray for this town. I pray for our city. Father, we're the believers in this town. Father, give us the vision, what you want. What do you want from us, Father? We're here. We're ready. We're available. Father, I pray for the believers in this room that they will be set free. Father, so many of us submit ourselves to slavery. You saved us from that. Not what it's about. It's about life in you and joy being in your presence. Father, we can have that every moment when you enter into our lives and you change us from the inside out. Father, save us tonight. Save us this morning. Father, if you're doing a work, Father, if you're doing a work, do it. There's people in this room that you're working on their hearts, Father. Grow their affections for you. Give them great affections. Let it be true. And Father, for these students that have said that they want to be set free, let it be true 6 months from now. Let it be true 10 years from now. Let it be true 10 millennia from now. That you are worthy. Worthy is the lamb that was slain, Father. For you are worthy. Father, do something in our town, Father. Let today be a monumental day in our city. Where you sense of revival. You change things forever. Father, we love you and we trust you. In your holy name, Jesus, amen. Amen. I just want to thank you guys for giving the students an opportunity to kind of take over this morning. I just want to thank both Pastor Kim, Pastor Keith, for just submitting to the Church Universal, showing us a great picture of what the body of Christ looks like in one town. I don't know, man, I say it every time, it's crazy. That's not how it's supposed to be, but we do it because it's the gospel. And so I'm just thankful that we present that and we can understand that. And so we're just going to kind of end with a, we have a hymn girls at Haga, some hands in motion team. I guess you guys can come on forward. We're just going to end with these girls doing a presentation for y'all, and that'll conclude DNOW 2015. So I'm just thankful for all the people that served and helped lead. There were hundreds of people behind the scenes that no one saw. I just want to be thankful for that this morning.
Sadness from wherever you've been. Come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find your mercy, oh sinner, come kneel. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. Oh, I'm broken. Lift up your face. Oh, wonder and come home. You're not too far. So lay down your hurt, lay down your heart. Come as you are.
Thank you, young ladies, and Chris, thank you. Dan, thank you for all your work, for all our host families, everyone who has provided food, everyone who's made this weekend possible. Thank you so very much. What a wonderful weekend. DNOW weekend is coming to a close. The invitation to be set free in Christ is not. And so if I can ever be of any help to you, to show you how to know the Lord, how to be set free in Christ, if Dan can be of any help to you, if Chris can be any help to you, if Pastor Ken can be of any help to you, please just seek us out and say, hey, I'm trapped, and I need to find my way out, and I want to know how Christ can set me free. We'd love to share that story with you. Would you stand, and let's be dismissed with God's blessing. There is a world out there that needs to be set free in the Lord Jesus Christ, so you go. And you give God glory, and you give people glory.